Jackie Christensen.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming out. You know, I've gotten to be pretty old. I've been through several companions, Annie, Polly, and the only way I could get this guy to be my driver was to marry him. Thank you, Wyatt Bill. Someone once told me, when you speak to an audience, you should look them in the eye.
Move the microphone up a little bit there.
Happy to. How's that? So, how much do you know about Helen Keller? Helen Keller showed great leadership in our country and beyond, long before the term women in leadership was ever even heard of. It was almost by accident that I got brought into being Helen Keller for my district's leadership conference back in 2007. It was a great skit and it was a lot of fun doing it. But it didn't take long before I had Lions asking me for more and more information about Helen Keller. The more I discover about this great lady, the more fascinating she becomes to me, and the more I love talking about her. But what's this about the Lions Clubs? How in the world did Helen Keller become so instrumental in Lions Clubs history? Today, I'd like to share with you a little bit of information about Helen Keller and about her involvement with the Lions Clubs. When I was in grade school, I had to do book reports, probably like most all of you had to do. One of my favorite books was about a gal named Helen Keller. All she was able to accomplish being blind and all she overcame just spoke volumes to me. I thought she was pretty fantastic back then. Little did I know that her and I's paths would cross all these years later when I became a Lion. Now, I don't know about all of you, but Helen Keller's involvement with the Lions Club never made any history book I ever read. It wasn't until I became a Lion that I learned how instrumental she was in Lions Club's history, and that made her even more phenomenal to me than I ever thought she could be. She was born Helen Adams Keller on June 27, 1880, in Tuscumbia, Alabama. At the age of 19 months old, she got sick with what is generally believed to have been scarlet fever, and she lost her hearing and vision as a result. Now, as Helen grew into childhood, she became wild and unruly because she didn't have anyone that could understand her and interpret her needs. But just a few months shy of her 7th birthday, Helen met Annie Saltman. Most of you pretty much know the story of Helen Keller and how Annie taught her to understand and interpret the world around her. And Helen was an insatiable learner. Helen was also the first deaf-blind person to ever graduate from college. She graduated from Radcliffe College, which was the women's version of Harvard, back in 1904. But Helen never stopped learning. She was an author, of course, having written the ever-popular Story of My Life, which was also made into a movie, and many other works, which many of you probably have never even heard of. Helen received many honors all throughout her lifetime, and she had a wide variety of interests. But Helen Keller never lost sight of the needs of the blind and the deafblind individuals. Helen Keller herself showed that severely disabled people could accomplish just about anything. Helen was instrumental in starting the American Foundation for the Blind back in 1921. She was a huge advocate for the blind, and she did many tours all over the world on behalf of the blind in order to raise awareness. So, what's this about the Lions Clubs? And what was her involvement? Of course, you all know Melvin Jones founded Lions Clubs International back in 1917. Melvin was a successful insurance salesman in Chicago, and he belonged to a local businessmen's group who regarded themselves as community leaders, but they never actually did anything for their community. And Melvin told his group, any association that presents to leadership in their community must have something more to offer than business reciprocity. Hence, Lions Clubs was born with the intent of service to the community. Now, Lions Clubs floundered for a while because they didn't have a major service activity that could really unify the organization. Every club's service was different. Some worked to help the blind, others disadvantaged children. They all had that clear-cut mission to serve society, but they didn't have a specific purpose. And the Lions wanted a purpose. They needed that vision they could fulfill. So because of this, Lion leaders encouraged members to attend the international convention held at Cedar Point, my home state, back in 1925, to help form association policies geared specifically toward the relief of handicapped children as their major service activity. Little did they know that one sightless person was about to change all of that. Of course, that sightless person was Helen Keller, who by 1925 was almost a near mythic figure. She was famous not because of what she did, but who she was. Helen was revered not just for her ample intelligence, but also for her dignity and her serenity. Helen Keller had not merely triumphed over her disabilities. She seemed to stretch the bounds of human possibilities. And Helen Keller became the match that lit the Lions' vision and made us all Knights of the Blind. Now, Lion leaders didn't promote Helen Keller's speech prior to Cedar Point because they hadn't been able to get her to agree to come to the convention, something they'd been begging her to agree to for almost an entire year. At the time, Helen and her teacher Annie were actually in California, where they were touring to promote and raise funds for the American Foundation for the Blind. It was almost at the last minute they decided they would come to Ohio and attend the international convention. Story has it, Helen had actually attended the Youngstown Lions Club on that day, and the Youngstown Lions Club got her to go to the convention. There was a gentleman that drove her to the convention, and word is, the car broke down on the way to the convention, and she almost didn't make it. Can you imagine where we would be today if Helen Keller had not mounted that stage? Thank goodness for Helen Keller. My friend, 7,500 Lions had filled the auditorium by the time Helen Keller mounted the stage. And of course, the Lions showered her with applause. Helen's voice was tiny, robotic, almost otherworldly. Helen Keller knew that this audience was quite unlike any other. You see, her normal pleas to audiences was for financial support. But here, Here was a unique opportunity to marshal the resources of the civic-minded. Helen's voice was not pretty, but her words poured forth with precision and power. Helen Keller spoke directly to the concerns and the interests of Lions. In less than 10 minutes, she changed the course of Lions Club's history and of those without vision or threatened by blindness, well, forever. And although I can't mimic her voice, I'd like to share with you her words to them over 90 years ago. I suppose you have heard the legend that represents opportunity. As a capricious lady who knocks on every door but once. And if that door isn't opened quickly, she passes on, never to return. That is, as it should be. Lovely, desirable ladies will not wait. You must go out and grab them. I am your opportunity. I am knocking at your door. I want to be adopted. The legend doesn't say what you are to do when several beautiful opportunities present themselves at the same door. I suppose you must choose the one you love best. I hope you will adopt me. I am the youngest here, but what I have to offer is full of splendid opportunities for service. The American Foundation for the Blind is only 4 years old. It grew out of the imperative needs of the blind and was called into existence by the sightless themselves. It is national and international in scope and in importance. And it represents the best and most enlightened thought on our subject that has been reached so far. Its object is to make the lives of the blind more worthwhile everywhere, by increasing their economic value and giving them joy of normal activity. Try to imagine how all of you would feel if you were suddenly stricken blind today. Picture yourself stumbling and groping at noonday, as if in the night. Your work, your independence, in this dark world, wouldn't you be glad if a friend took you by the hand and said, "Come with me, and I will teach you how to do some of the things you used to do when you could see?" The American Foundation for the Blind is going to be just that kind of friend to the blind in this country, if seeing people will give it the support it must have. You have all heard how through a little word dropped from the fingers of another, a ray of light from another soul touched the darkness of my mind, and I found myself, found the world, found God. It is because my teacher learned about me and broke through the dark, silent imprisonment which held me that I'm able to work for myself and for others. It's the caring we want more than the money. You see, the gift without the sympathy and the interest of the giver is empty. But if you care, if we can make the people of this great country care, the blind will indeed triumph over blindness. The opportunity I bring you, Lions, is this: to foster and sponsor the work of the American Foundation for the Blind. Will you not help me hasten the day when there shall be no preventable blindness? No little deaf, blind child untaught? No blind man or woman left unaided? I appeal to you, Lions, you who have your sight, your hearing, you who are strong and brave and kind. Will you not constitute yourselves Knights of the Blind in this crusade against darkness? Sitting in rapt attention, the Lions heard every word. Applauding wildly, they stood in mass as Helen finished her speech. Helen Keller touched the heart and soul of our organization. Before the delegates left Cedar Point, they voted to adopt sight conservation and work for the blind. And we have indeed been known the entire world over ever since as Knights of the Blind, thanks to the challenge of this one beautiful, brilliant lady. No one, not even Melvin Jones himself, could have predicted the power that this one sightless individual could have over all of those of us with vision, to inspire us now for over 90 years to unleash the full humanity of those with disabilities, and indeed suddenly change a floundering organization overnight to become Knights of the Blind. My dear friend Helen Keller passed away on June 1st, 1968, just a few weeks shy of her 88th birthday. Unfortunately, today we still fight this battle, but we honor our vision. We all provide eye exams and eyeglasses to the needy. After we completed Campaign Sight First 2, we were able to raise over $200 million to help us further that cause presented by Helen Keller so many years ago. One of these causes is river blindness. Did you know that just $6 can cure river blindness for one person in Africa and Latin America? $6. That's less than the cost of my lunch at work every day. Now, I don't know about all of you, but I could do without lunch for about a week, maybe two, and so could my waistline. But the important thing is, not only are we reversing this blindness, but we're allowing these people to be able to return to their rich lands and revive their local economies. My friends, you can't get much better than that. What other organization in the world can say they can do that? You all can't, because you're Lions, and you know what that means. We've already been able to eliminate river blindness in Ecuador and Colombia. We're getting there. We're getting close. The other major preventable disease is trachoma. It's also the world's oldest infectious disease. But Lions Clubs International has developed a comprehensive long-range plan to totally eliminate trachoma off the face of this earth by 2020. Count them up, folks. That's just 3 years away. Now, I don't know about all of you, but I hope I'm still here to see that day. The oldest infectious disease in the world, gone off the face of the earth, because you helped get it. You helped to do that. And we've already been able to succeed in China. It's gone in China. In 2001, LCIF and the World Health Organization actually collaborated so they could address childhood blindness all throughout the world. This was a partnership that they called the Project for Elimination of Avoidable Childhood Blindness. They were able to establish 30 needs-based eye care centers in countries all over the globe, and especially at delivering preventive, therapeutic, and rehabilitative eye care services to 71 million children. 71 million children. My friends, these are just a few of the wonderful strides that Lions have made in our world today to help us eliminate avoidable, reversible blindness. Not to mention the many things that all of you do all around the world to help those without vision to lead a better, more normal, healthy, and active life. You are all doing great things. All of us are. In my home state of Ohio, our guide dog facility is Pilot Dogs, and most of our clubs donate. We all donate to eye banks, to eye research centers, in order to help the blind in our local economies, our local areas, as well as around the world. You are all doing great things. But you know what? We're also not all sighted lions anymore. We have many blind lions who have joined our organization because all of us know and understand just what it means to be a lion, to serve our world, to make it a better place. And my friends, you truly are Knights of the Blind. It's great to be a lion. Thank you very much.